Right, so the title is on Blackboard. It's going to be three lectures. And I'm very grateful to the organizers for setting this up in the first place and then for persevering and doing this in this format, better than nothing. I mean, there are non-trivial issues now which don't appear in normal conferences. So I have to apologize. Today I have to run to finish 5 minutes earlier and run away to another seminar in Moscow, like from Paris to Moscow in 5 minutes. So today I will not be able to take questions right after the talk, but I will also give a lecture on a Thursday and then on Monday next week. And so you are more than welcome to ask questions, answer them later. All right, so what I want to give you is some kind of overview of there will not be that much proofs and maybe not that many theorems even, it's rather a viewpoint on motives from something which eventually will be non-commutative, but it will come along kind of naturally. And so I have to again apologize. So it's a long story which developed over the years in kind of strange way. My own background is from algebraic geometry. This is where I come from. And this is where the story comes from originally, is some of it. But a large part of it was developed by algebraic topologists actually. And so we saw some of it in Kina's great talk yesterday, and we'll see more of it today and your third lecture. And since I'm not an algebraic topologist, I mean, I might not be very good with, say, references of who proved what. So I will give you some statements which I know are correct, but maybe I will miss some attributions, and I apologize in advance for that. It's very good that we actually have also a course by Tina on this book that Sian Madsen and so on to work, which forms a very important part of the story. So I feel kind of covered on that part. So anyway, but let me start from algebraic geometry, and even not algebraic, but kind of usual geometry. So if we have some kind of X, which is a C infinity manifold, and we want to consider its cohomology. And as we know, there are several ways to define it, which all give you in the end the same answer. I mean, there are many ways, but kind of the most standard ones are as follows. So first of all, you can think about homology, and you can represent it by cycles, some actual geometric objects in X, or if you want, you can do what they call singular homology, simplices your X. This gives you homology and cohomology with, say, integral coefficients or any other coefficients which you want. This is a nice theory which also works in topological spaces, so one approach. Another approach is, instead of this, you can think more cohomological. You can think in terms of sheaves on X and sheaf cohomology. But more classically, maybe you might consider check cohomology. So instead of considering cycles, you consider open covers, nice enough open covers, you write the check complex, so that kind of stuff. Again, this gives you cohomology with Z and a posteriori any other coefficients. And then there is a third thing which is specific for manifolds now. And this is Derham cohomology. And it has no coefficients, meaning that coefficients are reals. Coefficients are your base field. Represented by forms, and it gives you the same result. So all, I mean, it gives you the same result when you compare it. So the Derham cohomology is the same as usual, say, singular cohomology of coefficients in R. So all give the same result. And they share some properties which are kind of natural when you want to think about something as a cohomology theory. So this is, first of all, the thing is homotopy invariant. if you have your x, you multiply it by an interval, say. You want the round maybe an open interval, so it's a smooth manifold. Then you get the same thing as you had before. And then a version of it, which in the Sinfinity setting is basically the same statement, but let me state it separately nonetheless. So if you have something which you can think of as a manifold, so for example, submersion, and you consider the cohomology of the fibers, then they form a local system downstairs, so they're locally constant. So fiber of some point, and this is locally constant. Again, this has several guises. You can consider relative cohomology, which will give you a locally constant sheaf downstairs. In the Rank homology, you can have some vector bundles downstairs which have flat connection. The point is that if you move along your base of your family, the homology doesn't change. Okay, now let's go to algebraic setting. And the point is that in algebraic setting, kind of all three approaches survive to some extent, but they give you different things now. Let me stick to smooth. For now, algebraic variety over a simplicity, let's say, over a field K. Then the first approach, geometric approach based on cycles, eventually, after think long and hard and invoke multiplier theorems, gives you what is known as the Chow groups. Chow groups. Or algebraic K theory. So the two things are intimately related. Maybe K theory is even more important for me because it's somehow more fundamental, but the point is that this is a very good theory in the sense that this is really intrinsic. You don't impose anything on your variety, you just work with whatever is there already, either cycles for Chow groups or vector bundles or hidden sheaves for K theory, but so it's intrinsic. Very interesting, but hard to compute. It's notoriously hard to get handle. Okay, so this is the story. This is kind of the best replacement for singular homology in the geometric sense. Now, the story about check coverings. Well, the reason it worked in the usual topology is that you can always cover your Sinfini manifolds by something, by some affine sets which are small enough to be contractible. Algebraically, it's not possible anymore because if you take an algebraic variety and you take, I mean, the only topology you have a priori is a risky topology. And when you take kind of the smallest possible open cover, it will not be contractible at all. So if you're over C, say you have a curve over C and you remove points, and that's the only thing you can do, you remove points. You end up with an open curve without many points, and actually it's not contractible at all. The more points you remove, the more non-contractible it becomes. However, it is always of topological type KP1, so it's defined by its fundamental group. And then there was this great idea of Grothendieck that you should generalize your notion of a cover. Instead of just open subsets, you should consider coverings of open subsets. And if you develop that idea far enough, and if you're Grothendieck, you end up with a tal cohomology. Just a second. Sorry. Tal cohomology. Now, this still has some limitations because in algebraic geometry, we can only consider finite covers. We don't have infinite covers. So instead of the whole fundamental group of something, you only get profinite completion. And as a result, so you get some theory which is nice, which behaves nicely, but the coefficients have to be, well, you can take finite coefficients, but in practical, for practical applications, people prefer L-adic homology. So coefficients are QL, where this is some L. prime. And in characteristic zero, it's okay, but if you're in positive characteristic, then this should be different from the characteristic of your base field. And the story I'm going to present is mostly interesting in the situation where you're in positive characteristic. So let me, so this will be some kind of P, and this has to be different from. And now there's the third story, the Durham story. And this again works. Durham cohomology. So it again works nicely by theorem of Grothendieck. You can just do the very naive thing. You can define differential forms as exterior powers of the Cartesian bundle, and you think about it as an algebraic thing. And then if you're over C, a non-trivial but true statement is that this computes the same cohomology. So any cohomology class can be represented by differential forms with polynomial coefficients. So this works. This also works in characteristic P, but of course, here we have a problem, which is that the coefficients of our cohomology theory are, by definition, when you're working with Durham cohomology, the same as the base field. And originally, lots of this was developed in the course of proving the Weyl conjectures, and there people wanted to have something in positive characteristic, but cohomology theory with coefficient characteristic zero. So there's some kind of extension of this, which Grothendieck came up, which is called crystalline cohomology. So this has coefficients k, but then there's crystalline cohomology, which is sort of better. So first of all, it can now be defined for singular variety just as well. So x can be singular. B. Singular doesn't have to be smooth anymore. And moreover, it can have coefficients. So if you start with something over k, there is a version of cohomology which is defined of coefficients in the ring of Witt vectors of k. So for example, if your k is just fp, the prime field, then this will be a periodic number, periodic integers. I will speak more about this later. And not only they give you different things, it's not even clear how to compare them. So for example, if you want to compare Durham cohomology and Attell cohomology, then you see right away that if you're in positive characteristic, you cannot do it because the coefficients are different. One is L-adic where L is not P, whereas the other one, the Durham or crystalline story, has coefficients either in FP or maybe in ZP or QP, but it's still the same P. So there is a very interesting involved and long kind of long story about what comparison you can do, which is called periodic Posch theory. And I mean, it's due to many people, Fontaine, Faltings, and then in the end, Bellinson. And then in the end, I think it was finally completely resolved not very long ago by Bhagavad, Peter Schultz and Matthew Morrow. But even there, the statement is not obvious because it's not hard to find, it's not that obvious to, you can even find the context where a mean comparison theorem can be made. And as for K-theory, normally there is a map from K-theory to either of the other two, but it's very far from being an isomorphism. We don't expect it to be an isomorphism. And what we expect to be able to do in the best of possible worlds is to be able to correct our cohomology theory somehow, that in the end they compute something which is closer to K-theory. So that's the general outcome. But let me now discuss the behavior of all these three theories with respect to those standard operations which I mentioned in the beginning. So sort of homotopy invariance properties. So homotopy invariance. Here the story is again slightly different because we don't have an interval anymore. an interval is not an algebraic thing. You can either take the whole line, which is a fine line, or you can think really infinitesimally. You can take, I mean, we can't do it in the usual topology, but we can do it in algebraic geometry due to Grothendieck, so we can consider infinitesimal neighborhood of a point, very small neighborhood of a point. And here, the italic homology behaves exactly as you expect a cohomology theory to behave. So first of all, it's what is known. So I think the terminology is due to Voevodsky. It was not originally, originally it was not thought it could be very useful. So it's kind of a great discovery of Voevodsky that this leads to very interesting theories. So the property is called AY homotopy invariance. And this means that the homology of some X, basically, it means what you think it means. If you multiply X by a fine line, you get the same thing. And this is kind of a global statement. And another important thing here is that, and the banner is that K theory behaves similarly in the same way if you localize it at some L, or maybe complete some L. So complete it at L with the same proviso as before. So L is not equal to characteristic. By the way, if there are any questions along the way, I don't think I can see it very well. So if some, I don't know, if Grigory could announce them, that would be great.
Right. Dmitry, sorry to have interrupted you. There is a question for crystalline K or DVF in the question chat.
For crystalline, let me go back to that slide. Where W of K F or DVF DVF.
Yeah, the question sounds
so K will be K will be the residue field of
residue,
W,
yes,
K,
yes.
And coefficients is WK or fraction field of W. Okay.
Yeah. Either, I mean, there are both. There's WK, you can take the fraction field there.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I was about to answer, but okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right. And then for K theory, this is actually a highly non-trivial statement. In the end, just what I wrote is actually easier, but some generalization are not so easy. It's basically discovery of Suslin, which is called Suslin rigidity. And then another thing which I mentioned, you can work with algebraic geometry, is infinitesimal rigidity. And this is again just true. So a telco homology of some X, which is maybe non-reduced, maybe some kind of infinitesimal neighborhood of X and some ambient variety, is exactly the same as telco homology with reduction. So it doesn't fill nilpotent extensions. So this is the story for et al. Now, K theory. So as I said, if you consider K theory, say find coefficients or complete it at some L, then it's fine, but in generally, it's important to realize that K theory is not a one homotopy invariant. Well, it is if X is smooth. But as I said, all the theories actually make sense for singular X, and it's useful to consider them in full generality. So, And for smooth X, it's still true. That if you just multiply by a fine line, the K theory doesn't change. It's one of the basic theorems of Quillen when he kind of developed K theory. But in general, for singular X, is just not true. In a very bad way. I mean, they really are very, very much. And it's not infinitesimally. Let me put it like this. So it's not true anymore that K theory of X is the same as K theory of its reduction. So if we consider some kind of infinitesimal neighborhood, then K theory would change very much. In fact, we already saw this yesterday in Tina's lecture, where you consider, for example, basic example, Z mod P and Z mod P square. And K theory of Z mod P we know, K theory of Z mod P square we don't even know. So that they're completely, I mean, not completely different, but they change drastically. There's a whole story about how K theory changes when you do infinitesimal deformations. So in this sense, K theory does not behave in the way you would expect cohomology theory to be. So here it's useful to mention that there is this complete, especially if you're in positive characteristic, there is this complete dichotomy. So you can sort of take your K theory and localize it at some prime different from the characteristic, or at the prime equal to the characteristic. And the answers are totally different. Already for the point, so if you just consider the prime field, both have been computed by Quillen, but the answers are different. So if you computed L coefficients of L not equal to P, then you get some kind of Bott periodicity, you get some polynomial algebra in one generator in degree two. Well, if you do FP bar maybe. So it's kind of similar to topological K. And if you do it at P, then K theory of a point only, there is only K zero, there is nothing else. So already here the behavior is different. But when you start, taking some kind of infinitesimal neighborhood of a point, so for example, lifting it to Z mod P to the power N, or maybe considering truncated polynomials, then there is this relative K theory which we saw. And that relative K theory is entirely P local. So if you localize at L, you get rigidity doesn't change. And if you look at P, then it changes very much. So the two stories behave in a very different way. And the kind of periodic P local story is not at first similar to cohomology. And now the crystalline cohomology.
Dmitry, there is a question. Does there any kind of A1 invariant K theory?
You can force K-theory B to be A1 invariant. But for my purposes, this is exactly what you don't want to do because it completely kills off what you want to study. This is some kind of dichotomy. So there's like the whole theory of motives of Vygotsky is kind of based on the ideas that things should be A1 invariant. And it really leads you very far when you do L-logic stuff. But for periodic stuff, I don't think it's, I think it basically kills off the interesting part. So I would prefer not to do that. But even before you go to K-theory, which is very difficult, let's discuss what happens with crystalline cohomology. And here it's like this. So it's kind of an infinitesimal invariant. I mean, not completely invariant, but so. At least if you have a family, it's kind of locally constant. So you have a family and you look at the fibers, then downstairs you get a bundle with flat connection. Of course, the problem is that, say, if you don't even do crystalline, but say do just the Ram cohomology in positive characteristic, it's true that you get a flat connection. It's the same story over any base field. The problem is, of course, that in characteristic P, flat connections give you less than you expect. So it doesn't give you like a trivialization to all orders. But at least it gives you a trivialization of some kind of what they call Frobenius neighborhood. So up to the power of P, you're okay. And in general, I think the full statement is that crystalline cohomology doesn't change if you do some kind of infinitesimal neighborhood which has an additional structure called divided powers. So there is some story you can do there, kind of locally compact, but certainly not a one homotopy invariant. Not a one homotopy invariant. And actually, there is a very easy geometric way to see why this happens. So now I have to. Yeah. So geometric reason. Now, I don't give you the definition of crystalline cohomology nor of K-theory. Well, because there is no time, of course, but also because it's not that important. What's important is the properties. And the basic property of crystalline cohomology which you need to know is the following. So if you have some X over this K. Sorry. And for now, let me fix K to be a perfect, perfect field of characteristic P. Say finite field of characteristic P would be good enough. And it can happen that this thing can be actually lifted to something defined over the suite vectors. W of K, and there is some kind of lift. That always happens. But if it happens, then the crystalline cohomology of X just computes the Durham cohomology of this lift. And then if you have a lifting, then crystalline cohomology of X is the same as the Durham cohomology of the slit. And if you look at something like a projective line, for example, then it has, of course, a lifting. And so crystalline cohomology of P1 is what you expect it to be. So there's this base, which is W of K is one dimensional. There is a special point in the base, and the fiber of a special point is P1. And then you want to leave. Okay. Now, if you want to consider A1, you just take some point, the special fiber, and remove it. So there is no more point. Does this have a lifting? Well, it does have a lifting, but it's not what you expect. So here we have A1. One minus infinity. But this lifting is not this minus any kind of lifting with infinity. Formally, by definition, this X twiddle has to periodically complete. So you have to complete it. This means that you not only remove one point, removing one point would correspond to remove, you know, a single section of your family. But basically, remove all the sections which pass through this point infinity at zero. So we remove this, 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 all this have to be removed. And in the end, you end up with lots of hole in the general fiber of your story, lots of holes in the general fiber of your lifting. So it's not just P1 minus infinity. It's basically P1 minus anything which reduces to infinity modulo P. And this has lots of cohomologies, as you expect, because you take a curve and remove lots of points. Each point creates your cohomology class. So H1 crystalline on a fine line is huge. And so some people think it's a bug and try to correct for this. And there are ways to correct for this using rigid analytic spaces and maybe putting log structure. I mean, there are lots of interesting stories about how to correct this and make crystalline cohomology behave more like you would expect a cohomology theory to behave. But on the other hand, you can think about it as not a bug, but a feature, as something which is intrinsic to the nature of crystalline cohomology and work with it. And this is the viewpoint I want to adopt.
Dmitry, sorry to have interrupted you. Willy Cartinas asks, when a lifting exists, that crystalline cohomology with p-adic integer coefficients lift to the Durham with same coefficients, or you need to pass to p-adic rationals?
No, it's true integrally. So a lifting has to be smooth in algebraic sense, but then it's true W of k coefficients. Of course, you can after that invert p, but you don't have to. But what you have to do, you have to complete your lifting periodically. So it really has to be some kind of formal scheme, because the story is really about infinitesimal, a series of infinitesimal lifting rather than any geometric lifting with a genuine geometric fiber. So it's true integrally, but it has to periodically complete.
Okay.
So this for A1, what you get will be actually torsion, but we'll be lots of it. So to annihilate by P, but there'll be lots of it. Okay. Now, kind of my general goal in these lectures would be the following, roughly speaking. So I want to leave completely aside the Tal story, which is orthogonal to what I want to present. But I want to think about K-theory and crystalline cohomology, and I want to show that the two phenomena are actually related. Show that the two phenomena, meaning that neither K-theory nor crystalline cohomology really behave in the way we expect cohomology to behave, are related. And actually, if you start thinking about K-theory, it just inevitably leads to crystalline cohomology. If you don't know about crystalline cohomology at all, but you think about K-theory long enough, you discover crystalline cohomology automatically. And that's kind of the message which I want to explain. And then as an additional bonus, it will turn out that this whole story actually just is naturally defined in a much bigger generality. Namely, you don't start with a ring which is commutative. You don't have to start with an algebraic variety. You can actually do it for any associative unit or not necessarily commutative ring, or even DG algebra. So this whole story turns out to be non-commutative, which is kind of an added bonus, which I think was originally expected, but now it's accepted. But I mean, let's not rush. It will just come up by itself. Okay. So let me start the story. I told you what the story should be, and now let me actually start doing it. So I need to tell you at least something about crystalline cohomology, right? So I told you one thing is that when you have a lifting, it gives you the lifting. But kind of one other thing I want to know about crystalline cohomology is the following. Assume that X is smooth now. Again, over K, which is perfect characteristic. Then, although it was not the original definition, there is a way to compute H-crease of X in a way which is similar to the Durham cohomology. Namely, it's canonically isomorphic to cohomology of X with the Zariski topology of coefficients in certain replacement of the Durham complex, W omega X. So this W omega X is something which behaves as the Durham complex. So it's canonical, it's functorial with respect to at least say local isomorphisms and gluings and so on. It's called the Durham with complex. I think it was the original idea of Bloch, and it was later developed and the story was fully done by Illouzi, but with lots of input by Deligne, apparently. I mean, the paper is by Illouzi, but if you read it, he says very often that this and this and this was done by Deligne. And it's a story from like mid to late 70s. So I don't really want to know, don't need to tell you what the whole complex is, but its first term, kind of what replaces functions, is something which has been around for quite some time already then. So W omega zero of X. Omega zero of X is just functions. And then here what you have something which is this thing called ring of weight vectors. Now this already appeared, of course, but there I did it for a field. And if you didn't know what this was, you could just think that this is, you know, like ZP. But now OX is certainly not a field. It's a polynomial ring of many variables, some relations. So I need to explain you really what weight vectors are. So recollection, kind of, this was recollection on H-Cris, and now kind of sub-recollections. What is this? So at the very least, it's a functor from commutative rings to commutative rings. But actually, at this point, the fact that it's a ring will not be that important to me. So let me first describe it as an abelian group. So it's a functor from rings to abelian groups. And there are many ways to present the story, but one is the following. You first define something bigger. So as an abelian group, consider something which is denoted blackboard. So you have starts of some A now, which is commutative ring. That's the only requirement. And then you find some abelian group which is called big universal with vectors and denoted by blackboard W of A. And by definition it's the following. So big vectors. No. It's basically the most naive thing you can do. So you have something which is possibly in characteristic P, and the goal is to have something which is not annihilated by P. You have a commutative ring, you have it additive group, and that's of course the same characteristic as A, but you also have the multiplicative group. So let's look at this. Of course, multiplicative group of A may be very difficult, but you can add one formal variable of the denoted by T. So you can see the formal power series in A, in one coefficient in A, in one formal variable T, and you can see the invertible power series. So there is a map which, so power series is of course invertible if its leading term is invertible, if and only if. So there is a map which sends something to its leading term, and this is split, because you can always take any invertible element in A, you can take it as a constant power series. So this splits as, so this is A star plus something else, and this something else denote W. Sometimes you can always write, you can see it in literature, it's written as 1 plus T A. So these are form of our series of leading term 1. And the group operation is multiplicative. So that's W. Now there is a way to look at it which is slightly, which looks a little bit too complicated. So instead of considering the multiplicative group, I can do the following. So instead of A star. We can actually consider algebraic K theory, but not like higher K theory, but just K1. We'll take K1. Okay. Now, the definition of K1 we actually saw in Kino's talk yesterday, fortunately. It's actually very close to a lower upper star. So this is a upper star, occasionally plus something else. But this something else, it can be non-trivial, but it will be the same for A and for power series. So when you do kind of the difference, it will not change. I mean, formal definition is you take GL infinity and you take its first homology or abelianization. And you can take determinants. So this gives you a map to A star. It's not always an isomorphism, but it's not that far. And it certainly will be kind of relative isomorphism if you look at power series. So in fact, it's also true that K1 of A is K1 of A, canonically splits into this plus W. Now, why is it useful? So I give you definition, I mean, we saw the definition of K1 in terms of GLN, but there is also a more invariant way to define it. And the point of more invariant definition is that it's actually not an invariant of the ring, but an invariant of the category of projective finitely generated models over A. So actually, K1, in fact, all K theory depends only on, let me denote this by P of A, which for me will be the category projective finitely generated A modules. And particularly its functorial aspect. So you have some functors between this category and the functor. And there is one obvious functor. If you have some vectors, let me now stick with situation when A is K algebra for simplicity over some K. Then if you have some K finite dimensional vector space equipped to the endomorphism, then you consider a functor which just, you know, just tensor product with V. And it's a functor from A of T, from projective models over T to itself. So you take your module tensor it with A, and you twist the action of T by this small a here. And so this is a functor, so it uses a map on K1. So for any VA, you get an endomorphism of example. Take some integer. Consider the cyclic group. Take corresponding, well, group algebra and dimensional vector space, and A, let A just act by the generator. So it's just, you know, shift, just free action of Z mod N on itself kind of permutation of like cycle of order n permutation. So this is a vector space on the endomorphism. So it gives you a well-defined map. So get epsilon, let me denote by epsilon n, OSV. But then if you take a product of V with itself, you see that as a vector spatial endomorphism, it's just a sum of n copies of itself, right? This means that this epsilon n is actually almost an idempotent. It squares to n times itself. And this can be used. So if, so we're now in a situation where, so it's A over K, so assuming that now that K is characteristic P as A, that I always assume, then it's easy, very easy to prove and easy to see actually that as a group, as an abelian group, this W of A is actually P local. So everything not divisible by P is invertible. This means that if N is not divisible by P, you have a well-defined endomorphism of your W of A. You can divide this epsilon N by N, this is well-defined, and this is an idempotent. So it squares to itself. And in fact, you can show that the whole W of A actually splits into a copy of, so you have a family of commuting idempotent endomorphisms numbered by all positive integers not divisible by P. And in fact, what happens is that the whole W of A just splits into the product of copies of a single thing, which is denoted now by just W without black borders. And this is called a group of, so this is just, if you want, the common kernel of all those idempotents. And so this is known as a group of p-typical with vectors, and this is what I want. Where am I? Yeah. Known as p-typical with vectors. There's an additional theorem that this has a product, so it's actually a ring, and this is my with vector ring. But for me, it's not important that it's a ring now. But what is interesting is that it turns out that exactly the same construction now gives you the whole Durham width complex. And this was not realized at first, but so there is one correction. So I was working with K1. But we have the whole algebraic theory, so we have an, and then of course, formal power series by definition are just projective limits of truncated things, right? To take A of t modulo t n plus one maybe, and take inverse limit with respect to n. You can ask whether it commutes with K theory, and it does commute with K1, but not with higher K groups. So what I want to do I want to find say completed criteria of FT as this inverse limit. Well, it has to be homotopy limit. Maybe. So there's some technical things there, it doesn't matter. Of K groups of truncated polynomials. And then again, there is always the augmentation map to the leading term, which is split. So you can say that this thing splits as K theory of A plus something. What is denoted by X for now. Exactly the same. So again, all K theory depends on the category of models. So you have the same idempotence. Kind of relative. So this X, this second term, kind of unquote. You can also think about it as relative K theory of this. This is P local. So you can always also look at the those idempotents I have, look at those kernels. And the theorem is that this gives you exactly the terms of the rhombic complex. So A is now smooth commutative. Maybe finitely generated. So just algebraic, smooth algebraic variety. You know, finitely generated. Algebra, test this complex, and then in degree I, this thing is naturally identified with this common kernel epsilon I on relative K theory. So let me rewrite this. So I take this K complete relative degree I plus one. I take the common kernel of all those idempotents epsilon n acting on this guy. And this gives you term of the rhombic complex. So the point is, I mean, the gist of this is that if you just replace K1 with higher K theory, you automatically, without thinking, are led to crystalline cohomology, the rhombic complex and crystalline cohomology. Now, this theorem has a long history. So actually, it was originally conceived by Bloch because the paper where he actually introduced the ideas for the rhombic complex, it was called On P-Typical Curves and Algebraic K Theory. But it was maybe even before, or at least right after Quillen's K theory appeared. So he worked with the previous version, which was Milner K theory. And he could only do it in like small degrees and so on. But then the story developed, and I think eventually the theorem is due probably to Lars Hesselholt. I think people on the audience.
Sorry, a quick question. Is it obvious that the chain complex structure on these relative K hats?
It's a priori spectrum. Well, when I denote KI, I write, I mean a homotopy group. A posteriori, it is actually, but it's not obvious, no. So it is an Ellenberg-MacLane spectrum, it is a chain complex. And then, so this is one question. And then another question is, so I get this W individual terms. Another question is, where is the differential, right? The Durham differential. And this is kind of the next question, which I'm going to address on Thursday, and the kind of one-line kind of punchline is that it comes from a circle action on this relative case theory. But this will really have to do. I mean, there's no time for that today. I'll explain that on Thursday.
Okay.
But the result itself is due to Lars Hesselholt from, I don't know, like, so he has a paper whose title is very similar to Bloch's. It's called On P-Typical Curves and Quillensky Theory. But even then, it uses lots of technology. So I'm not really sure what is the good reference for this. It's not so direct to prove. And I'm not going to prove it in these lectures. But the one I'm going to present in these lectures is the way to see that this thing here is actually very computable. It's related to some pure combinatorial invariant which you can compute. And then how to identify that to the Drum-Witt complex is a separate story, which is not that interesting, actually, combinatorics. But kind of the main thrust will be this. And I will explain first, the first thing I explain on Thursday is how to get the Drum differential on this thing. So it's really not just terms in the Drum-Witt complex, but the whole complex. Okay. Now I think I have to run now, more or less.
Okay, let's thank the speaker for today's lecture. And please prepare your questions and comments for Thursday and Monday lectures, please.
Yeah. So
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.